Hello everyone, Matt Flummer here, and I am professor of philosophy at Porterville College, and I'm making a series of videos on ethics for my students. We are going through Russ Schaefer Landau's book, The Ethical Life, if you'd like to follow along. Today's video is on chapter 18, David Enoch's excellent article on why he's an objectivist about ethics and why he thinks that you are too. So we'll start out with a joke. Imagine a child who explains to her mother how much she hates spinach. And she is so glad that she hates spinach. And her mother asks her, well, why? And the child responds, because if I liked it, then I would eat it. And it's disgusting. Well, David Enoch is actually going to use this joke, as part of an argument for moral objectivism. So first, before we get into the more jokes, let's talk about the difference between objectivism and subjectivism. When we think of objective facts, we usually think of, or at least I think of things like science. Objective facts are facts that are true independently of what anybody thinks about them. So for instance, the time that it takes for sunlight to reach the earth from the sun, that's an objective fact. And it doesn't matter what I think about it or what you think about it or what anyone else thinks about it. There's just a fact of the matter. And it's just true, regardless of what we think about it. Another example is the boiling point of water. So if we have pure water at sea level and we raise the temperature to 100 degrees Celsius, then the water's going to boil. That's an objective fact about the nature of water. And it doesn't matter what we think about it. It's just objectively true. According to moral subjectivism, we could think of subjective facts first. A subjective fact is a fact that depends on what people think about it. So it's a fact that I like cookies and cream ice cream. That's just a fact. But it's a fact that depends on my preferences. It just happens that I really like cookies and cream ice cream, and it's my favorite. My wife's favorite, on the other hand, is mint chocolate chip. And that's a subjective fact about her and her preferences. So when it comes to moral subjectivism, we combine subjective facts with morality. And there are moral truths, according to moral subjectivism. It just so happens that they are subjective to a person and what that person thinks or feels or some kind of attitude that they have, similar to my preference for ice cream. So according to subjectivism, they don't deny moral facts or moral truth and moral falsity. They just say that the truth and falsity of moral statements depend on a person's attitudes or a culture's attitudes. In a previous video, we talked about cultural relativism. And cultural relativism is an example. It's a kind of moral subjectivism. So moral subjectivism is a family of theories of morality. And there are several different kinds, like cultural relativism. Moral objectivism, on the other hand, thinks of morality more like the objective facts that we talked about earlier. There are true and false moral statements, and their truth and their falsity don't depend on what anybody thinks about them. They just are true. Now, sometimes this is called moral realism. This is a version of moral objectivism. And Enoch is going to use the spinach joke as an argument for moral objectivism. So let's see how his argument goes. We've already talked about the spinach joke. The little girl explains how she's so glad that she does not like spinach because then she would eat it and it's yucky. Let's consider another joke. Imagine someone saying that they are so glad that they don't live in the Middle Ages, because if they did, then they would believe that the Earth was the center of the universe, and it's not. Think that that one's funny? Well, let's try another one. Think of someone saying, I am so glad that I was not born in the 1700s in America, because then I would think that slavery was okay, and it's not. Okay, so my joke skills are lacking seriously, is what you were probably thinking. But there's actually a point to these jokes. There is something funny about the spinach joke, or at least mildly amusing. But there is nothing funny about the geocentrism and the slavery joke. And this is an interesting fact that does shed light on the nature of morality according to Enoch. He's going to develop an argument that he calls the spinach test that's based on these jokes. If you think about the difference between the funny spinach joke and the unfunny geocentrism joke, the difference between the two will shed light on the nature of morality. So why is the spinach joke funny, or at least mildly amusing, and the geocentrism joke is not at all? Well, Enoch explains that the main reason why we think that the spinach joke is amusing is that the child is trying to hold fixed her dislike of spinach while at the same time trying to imagine herself liking spinach. And what makes this amusing, this kind of contradiction that arises, is that when it comes to our personal preferences about the kinds of foods that we like, the only thing that counts as a reason about whether or not you like a specific food is whether or not you like that food. I mean, you think about reasons that you have for eating stuff that you like. It's just you like the taste, and that's the reason to eat it. On the other hand, when it comes to the geocentrism joke, it doesn't work. It's not funny at all, because the kinds of reasons that we think of for thinking that the Earth is the center of the universe are very different than the kinds of reasons that we think for eating spinach or not, whether we like them or not. The Earth being the center of the universe doesn't depend on our preferences at all. All that matters, or the kinds of reasons that we look for in this kind of case, are outside of ourselves, whereas the kind of reasons that we look for and the kinds of food we like is inside of ourselves. We just take stock of what our preferences are. But the Earth as the center of the universe doesn't work like that. And so that's why the spinach joke is amusing, but the geocentrism joke is not amusing. The next question that we ask is, well, is the slavery joke more like the spinach joke or more like the geocentrism joke? If certain subjectivists about morality are correct, like David Hume, when we say that slavery is wrong, all we're really doing is saying something about ourselves. We look inside of, like David Hume famously said, that you look inside your own breast, inside of yourself, and that's where the truth of the moral statement comes from. It is an expression of your own attitudes towards slavery. Well, if that's true, then the slavery joke would be more like the spinach joke. But it doesn't seem like the slavery joke is like the spinach joke. On the contrary, it seems like the slavery joke is more like the geocentrism joke. And the kinds of reasons that we look for slavery, don't come from inside of us. They come from facts outside of ourselves, like the geocentrism example. And so Enoch thinks that this fact about the differences between the geocentrism and the spinach joke are going to help us develop a kind of test or an argument for whether or not something counts as objective. So let's take a look at the way this goes. If we think about any relevant subject matter, we can form an analog of the spinach joke. And we think about, does the joke work or does the joke not work? If the joke works, then it seems to indicate that the subject matter depends on us and our responses, our attitudes, our preferences, our likes and our dislikes. If the joke doesn't work, then it seems like the subject matter is objective, like astronomy or whether the Earth is the center of the universe. So, when we apply this test to moral issues, like slavery and racism and child abuse, it seems like the joke doesn't work at all. And in that case, it seems like morality falls squarely on the objective side. Okay, so that's the spinach test.